thank you for coming. And as Manoj mentioned, I represent a company, but that's why. Sorry, can I start the? Can we start the presentation? But on the other hand, I am representing a non-commercial institute where we do a lot of basic research, international collaborations, and so on. That's why the data that I will present you are from the SQKIP Institute. It's a non-commercial institute where we invite people from all over the world working in SQ, other in these facilities from the SQKIP Institute, and even we sending people out. At the moment, there's a professor from Israel, Aaron Lerner. He's for 1 year doing his sabbatical. There's a lady from Spain. There's one guy from UK and some other people. So at the moment, there are 6 people or 7 people in the institute. And what I want to talk about is about celiac disease. The first mistake we already corrected. I'm not from US, as you realize from my English too. That's why, first here, I want to show you, wait. Here, that's my faculty disclosure, that I'm the owner of the company, but on the other hand, I'm the head of a non-commercial institute. I have to do it. Here, sorry, how I can do it? Where? Ah, okay. So we are in the middle between Tokyo and New York. Tokyo's here, New York is there, and close to Frankfurt. And next time, next slide, please. If you tell me where is he? Mohamed, can do you me one favor? Can you press a button for the slide? Then I have not. Thanks. Okay. It works or not? Okay, thanks. This is the area where we are located. It's a very nice area. The institute and the company are in the middle of green vineyards, and so this is really, there's nothing around this. So this is, are the buildings, and we are the only one there in this location. And so we are working there, and it's really nice. Some people like it and see it's like Napa Valley when they're visiting us. So I did the second mistake, to be honest, when I prepared this lecture. I gave them the wrong title, Many Faces of Celiac Disease. And then I realized how many work it is to explain you what we have done in the last 12 years, because where I should do the focus. Should I do the focus in the clinics? Should I do the focus in the diagnostics? Or should I do the focus on the pathology, because we have done a lot of work in the pathomechanism of the disease and so on. And I realized yesterday it's a practical, even a practical approach here, this Congress, and I like him very much because I was listening yesterday a lot of lectures. So I have to change everything, and then I start how I can start and how I can do it. So I try to explain a little bit why I think it's very complicated sometimes to diagnose the disease. The other thing I want to tell you, that there are now better tools for diagnosing so that you have a practical approach. And on the other hand, I give you an approach of how the disease can be developed and what at the end has an impact on the treatment and on the better diagnosing the people and what's the outcome for the patients maybe. So I try to do this in 30 minutes, German time. So be honest, I will be finished there. So, and I realized when I start this, now I know why it took 2,000 years to find from the first description of the disease by Aratheus of Cappadocia 2,000 years ago until in 1887 that they talk about celiac again. And I think it has to do with some of these names. If there comes a patient to you and you stick them to osteoporosis, or there are some patients, dermatitis, herpetiformis, ataxia, thyroiditis, rheumatoid arthritis, diabetes, and so on, you will never think about celiac. Because he has a thyroiditis, why we should check for celiac or diabetes. Meanwhile, there are a lot of these groups are claimed they are risk groups, and you have up to 1 in 22 is celiac. And Fasano and the other groups in from US published that celiac is one of the hypotheses is a driver for other autoimmune disease. Every celiac disease patient that you detect very late will develop other autoimmune diseases. And this has not to be only one or two, it can be even three. So they describe cases where they have really a lot of cases that celiac is the driver for the other autoimmune diseases. I think you have no problems if a patient comes and he claims, I have diarrhea, they have weight loss, retard growth, anemia, malabsorption. It's very clear, you will check for celiac and in the most cases you will find it. How you can find it, the diagnosis at the moment will be confirmed by autoantibodies. That's why they claim it's an autoimmune disease. The biopsy, or you check the HLA classes, they are related with DQ2, DQ8. But then comes the next point. Then we're discussing sometimes in studies, the prevalence of your study or what you find in celiac is, it's too high. And why? Because you see in Europe, the numbers are around 1%, then in US, 1% and so on. But then you look worldwide, and there are a group, they call it Saharawi. It's in the northern part of Africa. There's one in 18. And you will find much less in a special area in Latin America where they have one in 682. If you look for these figures and you see how broad or how wide is the range of celiac disease, so you can understand that if you found sometimes 2%, you think, oh, it could be too high. But there are some groups like diabetes where they have up to 7% inside. So it depends. And all of this, that's why I want normally to claim many phases of the diseases, why it's made sometimes so complicated to find the right diagnosis. Why it's important to find it. If you look, okay, and this is some of our publications where we were finding out that even celiac growth belongs with heart and skin diseases. So it's published by Professor Lerner and me. And, but why it's so important? If you look in the publication from Fasano, when he started in 2003, he did a very huge epidemiological study, and he found out one in 133 person. But this is not why I want to show you this. It's claimed it's 1%, and it will be, it's okay. But what is more important, that he claimed in 2003, 97% of celiac patients are undiagnosed or misdiagnosed. And 12 years later, in 2015, they did the same study and they come to 83. That means still 83% of the celiac patients are misdiagnosed or you cannot find them. So, why it's so important? Because if you check how long it takes sometimes to find the right diagnosis, these are the shortest time. In the meantime, it's around 4 years. But if you take 4 to 12 years to find celiac or give the patient the celiac disease diagnosis, he has a chance from around 70% to get other autoimmune diseases. And you see immediately, if it goes longer and longer, over 20 years, you have already 34% a chance to develop other autoimmune diseases. That means other complications, and so on. Meanwhile, there are publications, diabetes, if you found the patient in the right time, you can prolong the time for the outcome of the or outbreak of the diabetes around 10 years. Osteoporosis, if you found the right patient, stick them to gluten-free diet, the bones will recover and you have a good success. So, then look in the other, why it's sometimes complicated to diagnose celiac disease in the right way, because all these diseases like gluten sensitivity, wheat allergy, and celiac have the same symptoms. They have diarrhea, they have pain, the patient's coming and complaining about the pain. But okay, there are two things how you can discriminate the wheat allergy very easily, because it takes only minutes, 2 hours. But to find non-celiac gluten sensitive patients, it's very difficult, because they go maybe in a restaurant, eat a pizza, and 2 days later they get pain. They come to the doctor, but they don't correlate the pain with the 2 days ago. So it's very hard to even diagnose this patient, because all of them, it's very easily, the therapy is stick them to gluten-free diet and they will become better. But this group is very interesting, because this group is claimed to be up to 10% in the population. And not all of them, in my opinion, I will show you later on why, are only what we claim non-celiac gluten sensitivity, because they are only claimed and get this diagnosis because at this time they don't fulfill the S-Vagan criteria. They have no positive biopsy, they have no positive antibodies, and so on. So that's why they were claimed non-gluten, non-celiac gluten sensitive. But some of them have even the same share the same HLA classes. And I expect, and I show you some data from our, that they become later on celiac patients. So how is the situation today for the diagnosis? So you have no marker for gluten sensitivity. Wheat allergy is very simple, and even you have it in some minutes. And then you have some marker for celiac. You have DGPs, you have gliadin, you have TTG, and so on. But even there are some misunderstanding. In the last congresses, in the last two congresses, they were talking about DGP, because most people believe that DGP is a marker for pediatric samples or for children. And definitely there are so many studies now, and they told very clear that DGP is not a marker for children. So you cannot use it for children and for the diagnosis. So then you have marker for dermatitis herpetiformis, TG3, and you have gluten ataxia, TG6. So, but what's the problem with celiac? You have some markers, you say, okay, I think we have enough, it's fine. But when we started our studies in 2002, we realized that only you can pick up the symptomatic, because we had a nice collaboration with the Frankfurt University, with Professor Stein, Professor Kaspari. I provide them very proud, our first TTG kit was in 2000. They used them a long time, and then they were complaining. They say, very nice, you have a great kit, we compared with other companies, it's really the best one, or we can use them, but you don't pick up our patients. I say, why? You say it's very good and so on. No, they were discussing about patients that they called silent and latent. So we start with the Frankfurt University at this time, a very nice study about latent and silent celiac patients. So how we did it? We were looking for how we can cover all of them, and not only with TTG, or that we get even the silent and potential patients. If you look in the TTG family, you have 9 transglutaminases. Every transglutaminase has a different function. And what we claimed, you have a marker for dermatitis herpetiformis, gluten, ataxia, celiac. So then we were looking, okay, first, maybe we can combine the both enzymes, the 3 enzymes, put them in one, and maybe we get a better result. Was not possible. Then we combine something else and so on. We try a lot of the transglutaminases and try to pick up the silent and latent. Then we were looking in the function of the celiac, of the tissue transglutaminase. And the function, what everybody forgot is, everybody is talking about deamidation, but deamidation is only 25%. And then we were checking, okay, what is this enzyme really doing? It makes transamidation. Like the factor 13 in the blood is the transglutaminase, he closed the wounds. Yeah? So they make transamidation. What does it mean? They make a complex. They use the gliadin peptides that they are produced in our body. They use the enzyme, and then they make a cross-linking about enzymes and peptides, and comes to a complete different conformation. This conformation we claimed neoepitopes, and we started in 2003 a lot of studies, and I will show you, present you some of them to give you an idea why we did it and why we believe it's wrong. It's right, sorry. So we started with the UC Davis, University of California. This is Eric Gershwin. He's very famous for PVC, but even he has really great ideas when you start about complexes and so on. And so we started to talked with him and we started very nice work about these complexes. And the nice thing is, since 2015, that's the latest publication, we are not the only one. There's a group from Solid, they published in 2015 in the Congress in the ICDS, that's the biggest congress for celiac. They published that these complexes will be presented to the T cells and B cells and you get antibodies. That's the first time that another group than ours, because sometimes it's, if it comes from one group, they think, oh, they have a nice patient and they published something. But now a lot of people talking about neoepitopes, they describe the complexes, they're looking at the structures and so on, and it starts now. So we started in 2002 and we measured more than 100,000 samples. But I talk about celiac samples, not only samples, celiac patients. We were looking for every center that is very famous for celiac. One was in Ireland, one was in Spain, the other was in US and so on, and we were looking to show that this, what we developed, has a very good performance as a screening assay. Screening assay, that means you have another problem. In the celiac population, you have sometimes IgA deficiency. So up to 3% they have IgA deficiency. That's why we start first combine IgG and IgA so that we don't miss any patients because of IgA deficiency. The second is to prove that the complex is much better. We want to check different. We want to check pediatricians. We want to check adults. We want to check the hepatitis, dermatitis herpetiformis. We want to check the other because we believe that the complex is a general complex that you find in gluten sensitivity. So then we were going, we were correlating with the biopsy, the Marsh criterion, and we were looking if it's earlier or brings benefit to the patients. So we started a study in Ireland with Stan McMillan. He was a leader in the celiac field at this time, and he had more than 11,243 patients. And then we were looking for the outcome of the biopsy and so on. And I had a very bad starting point. He was using our TTG kit, then I brought our neoepitopes, and then he was calling me after 3 months. He said, okay, take your crap out. I said, why, what's happened? He said, okay, you have too many positives. I say, okay, Stan, can we do the following? Can we try, because I believe that it could be earlier and so on. Can we try a little bit longer? So he tried 3 months longer, so he gave me half a year. And after 4 months, he called me, oh, now becomes the EMA positive, TGG, I checked the clinics, the patients are celiac, you're fine. Okay, then I told him, okay, maybe we can make this study bigger. So it was my first approach, and the guy was very famous. At the end, we got sensitivity of 100%, and we had a specificity of 98%. So he was happy, we were happy, and we compared with gliadin, we compared with all the tests that they were in Ireland that they're using there. So then we did a study, epidemiological study with Glenn Reeves, he's very famous in Australia, and he collected 2,684, not patients, people from, that's not correct, people from the street and want to check how is the incidence in Australia. So then comes, okay, there was a lot of women, then they have to give their age, they have to tell something about other things, so the women were going out of the study, no. But at the end, we had 244 celiac patients, and he was comparing all the ELISAs that he found in the world, and at this time, so, and he used our, what we call CeliCheck, and this is with the neoepitopes, and at the end, he comes to the result as the best screening test. So this was only to some short studies about screening so that you can pick up more patients. I can show you the correlation with the Marsh criteria. That was a study in Spain that we did in a very famous center. And we had a big problem because there was a lady. Her daughter got a positive result in our assay. So she was complaining. She wants to sue the hospital because she said, oh, my daughter cannot have CD. Okay, later on they started the study and want to see how good our kit is because she moved to another hospital, there was another company and the daughter was negative. So, and then we were in a, this hospital were in a not so good situation. They want to figure out, okay, I make it short. After 2 years, the children becomes positive, and they become, they realize that the mother was a celiac patient. But she don't want to have that her child want to have celiac. So there was only emotional, and she don't want that her daughter has celiac. So we did a nice study, and in this study we realized that the other company missed more than 20% of the patient. This is not because of the test is bad. This is because they use TDG as an antigen. And I will show you why in the later. So, and the specificity was here a little bit higher. You can see 100%, it was 94%. But our correlation to the Marsh criteria was much better. So we correlate much better with Marsh from Marsh 1 to Marsh 3. So then we did again studies in Ireland because Stan McMillan was a leader at this time in this field, and he found the same, that the kit correlates very well with the Marsh criteria. And the nice thing is they stopped the biopsy. In Ireland, after they had so many experience, they stopped the biopsy and say why we should do biopsy if we know that the kit working very well, and they set a higher cutoff than we normally recommended, and say if I use this cutoff, we use this own cutoff, he said, then I don't need the biopsy. We can save the money and we have not to give a biopsy to the patients. Next was in pediatric. We had a study in US, in Utah, with 188 patients. We had the biopsy and so on. And we could show that the kit works very well in children. So then we had the proof that this antigen is even good in pediatric population. There was another study in Israel where they claimed how they used our kits. They used them as a screening. They confirmed with two other companies to be sure and so on. I don't know, it's published. I want to show only that it was even in children. So we did several studies in children. And then was the most interesting study. Then we start studies because we realized if the people becomes, if the patient becomes symptomatic, you have no big difference. If the patients are symptomatic, you find TDG positive, DGPs, gliadin, whatever, and then you have the neopitopes positive. But the benefit that the neopitopes has, you can measure patients 2 years before. And this was studies when we started in Italy with 1,006 patients, and then they found some patients that were only positive in the test, 34 patients. Then they were following them, and at the end they realized they were 2 years earlier. This study is like the same. And then we did a study in Spain with 60,000 patients, and they found more than 3,000 patients only positive in this test. So you can see the value of that, how many patients you really oversee. They published now, and everything was, they were correct. The specificity was 95%. So why? I think we can go studies by studies, but I want even to save some time for you. So then we were checking, because we believe that the first antibody that the patients will do could be this, maybe work even in dermatitis herpetiformis or gluten ataxia, because the complex, even TG3 and TG6, they should be similar. So we were looking in the dermatitis herpetiformis cohort. It's already published. It's a biomarker. It's a biomarker for this disease. So we were looking for, if you look in TG3, that is specific for dermatitis herpetiformis. So, and you look in the neopitopes, and they covered much more, but they covered even the right patients. And at the end, they have the right patients. And what you have to do is only to stick them to gluten-free diet. So, if you want to know exactly if they have the disease, especially, then you can confirm with TG3. But at the moment, we were looking for a screening test. So the same with gluten ataxia. We think could be a marker or could be against TG6. And I can tell you, all the parameters that we had here, they were only positive in TG6, was only two patients at the end. And all of them, the neopitopes even covered. So then we were looking for why it's possible. Why it can be that the neopitopes can be a marker for all of the disease, but specific. So you have the specificity was never less than 95%. That means you don't pick up any other. So then we were looking for which role would be the neoepitopes play in the pathogenesis? So because we were looking in some countries and we realized that the celiac disease is increasing. And then we asking why? Because of the genetic background could not be, because that was not so much increasing like the celiac patients. So, because of they changed their lifestyle. Because we did some studies in China, and we realized when they changed from rice to the Western style, the celiac patients really increased a lot. So, then we were looking what could be in the food. What could be trigger the celiac disease? What could be the reason? So we were realizing that there's in 1998 was introduced in our Western food, in the Western style food, an enzyme that called microbial transglutaminase. Okay, we said, oh, great, toll. This is really unbelievable. Transglutaminase should be the same and so on. So then we were looking for the homology of the enzyme because it has difference to transglutaminase. It's only 38 kilodalton. It is calcium independent and is not so specific like transglutaminase. That's why they are using it for 90% already for 90% of our food. So we were checking here. You can see that's why we did it. In all of this kind of food is transglutaminase inside. The microbial transglutaminase. So, I call it, by the way, the Al Capone effect, because Al Capone was not arrested because of his crime, because of tax reasons, when he had the tax and somebody calculated. So then we were looking what is in the microbiome, because you cannot explain that somebody 2,000 years described the celiac disease, and you come now with an enzyme that was introduced in 1989. So we were looking in the microbiome, and there are a lot of bacteria. They contain this enzyme. So for the pathomechanism, we are working really on this because the microbiota, and I make it short because everybody is talking at the moment about microbiota, but we started some years ago, has a big impact on our health. So even here's the pathomechanism, how the microbial transglutaminase will do the same like the transglutaminase, and will cause the disease at the end. So why? We did the same what we did with the transglutaminase. We used the protein modification, we used the same peptides, they are, by the way, negative for celiac disease, and we created complexes. Because when you look in the poor enzymes, they have not even 30% homology. So you cannot expect it goes to the enzyme, and the food industry claims this enzyme is not dangerous. But if you do the same process, what we did, and that's here, we did the cross-linking with TTG and the cross-linking with MTG, and then you have a 95% homology. So then we were checking the microbial tissue transglutaminase neoepitopes against the human neoepitopes because we had so many studies, we had so many results, could be similar. So then we were checking the enzyme alone, this was done with children. The enzyme alone has no reaction. TDG, you see, and this is what we showed even in the study. TGG, you will not pick up the children because if you look in the neoepitopes, here's a human tissue transglutaminase and here's a microbial. Both of them, after they did this cross-linking and we have purified the complexes to understand. When we purify the complexes, we separate the transglutaminase and we separate the gliadin peptides that were not reacting, we separate from the complex. So we isolate every time the complex and it is well characterized. So this is a reaction for IgG and this is a reaction for IgA. So first of all, you would expect looks a little bit similar. So then we did competition assays. And we put every time the antigen inside to avoid that the antibody can bind to the plate. And you can see only the complexes can compete the other. Also here the effect you can, it's not very huge the effect. If you put glycine in the SE, doesn't disturb. DGP doesn't react. TDG doesn't react. Only the structure of the complexes is similar and can block the antibodies. So then we were looking to the correlation to the Marsh criteria. This was done in Israel in Haifa because there's a nice children hospital, and Professor Lona was the head of this hospital, or still, and he was doing the biopsies, and we had a very nice correlation for both of the assays. So then we used the 198 samples, and then you see how powerful it is sometimes. You see here the tissue transglutaminase has only the IgG, has 12% sensitivity. The IgA has close to 60%. But if you look in the human neoepitopes, they have 97 or 98, and the microbial transglutaminase has 95 by 100% specificity and 94% specificity. So then we were looking for, could be microbial transglutaminase maybe a marker for non-gluten sensitivity or for celiac disease. So we did a study that was sponsored by the institute in our area, in the country, and we collected more than 138 RR patients, and we were giving to the doctor, the study was normally made for rheumatoid arthritis. We gave to the doctors iPads so that the rheumatoid arthritis patient has a benefit. They were picked up very early. We brought them to the hospital, and we organized at the universities, was together with 10 universities, that they get the right treatment in the right time. So was even done together with Abbott, a big pharmaceutical company. They want to sell Humira, it's clear. The outcome of the study was, if you pick up the patient, the rheumatoid arthritis patient very early, they don't need Humira. They don't need any biologicals. Was not so good for Abbott. But on the other hand, we gave them a very good, a very simple treatment. And the course of the disease was, we had no progression. We could not, we were doing the study over 4 years following the patients, and we expected that we can develop an activity parameter because we have one, it's called MMP3, but we want to measure the activity, and we want to see how the rheumatoid arthritis patient behaves. But the problem for us was there was no progression. Also there was not, the patient didn't get any flavor, nothing, so the bone erosion was not there. So the result from the study, and we presented to our country, is if you pick up the patient very early, give them the right treatment, you don't need biologicals at this time. So it was very cost effective for them, not so nice for it. So, but then we had all the sera, we had all the patients, we had, because we have this biobank still. So then we were looking, what can we do? Should we check maybe celiac in this patient? So we checked with the neoepitopes, microbial transglutaminase, and we found 22% positive in the microbial transglutaminase, but only 2% positive for the TTG new generation, the human tissue transglutaminase. So you can see the specificity is very high of this kit, and even the neoepitopes must be different because only 2% are positive in the celiac kit and 22. So that's why we are following this study. It's not finished yet. So we're checking the HLA classes, and we try to stick the patients. And the hypothesis at the moment is if you would stick this 20% or 22% to gluten-free diet, that the symptoms will disappear, because we believe at the moment it's not really rheumatoid arthritis, only symptoms like rheumatoid arthritis, and that the daily doctor sends them to the hospital because of they expect rheumatoid arthritis. So this is what we did and what we measured, and the outcome of this study was very interesting, because 4 years, the timeline, the first visit starts 4 years ago, you found only MTG neo positive. DGP was negative. Our kit was negative that we are using since years, was negative. And then later on, after 3 years, the first kit was becoming positive for the TTG new generation, the neoepitopes, and only in 2%. But this means maybe this could be, we cannot say it is, that's why we do more studies and so. Maybe it's related with gluten sensitivity. And only if you are gluten sensitive and you have the wrong genes, so like bad luck, you have DQ2 or DQ8, then you will start develop celiac. So what we try, and we did more studies now, but it's very difficult to get really this gluten sensitive patients. They are not celiac because of the diagnosis, of the criteria and so on. We start now another study just in US, and we try to collaborate with Professor Fasano at the moment. But this is so far the outcome. And the idea is we don't want to sell any additional diagnostic, but we think the benefit for the patient is if you pick them up earlier, then you can stick them to a gluten-free diet and all the other autoimmune diseases will be breaking out later, or you have a... So the idea is, what we try to do is, we try to create the ideal course. That means if you pick them up 4 years earlier, stick them gluten-free diet, we want to see what is the next. Or if you don't treat them, but this is not ethic, the problem with celiac disease is we could do much more studies. If you say, please take a little bit gluten. We have even one lady in the company, she's homozygote for DQ2. I try every time to give her a nice cake. No, it's not fair. But she reacts really heavily. We were in the Christmas market, she eat only the sausage. That's why we come to this observation. She was not eating the bread, she was eating the sausage. She was for 3 weeks sick. So that's how it starts sometimes. And it was very fun. No, our idea is we try to develop something where you can pick up the patient earlier, can give them the right treatment, and we will follow the story with the MTG. So I have to thank to all the people because they belong to the institute, and even Professor Lerner from the Haifa, and I have to say thank you for your attention. We would like to do more here, Manoj. That's why we started with 40,000 samples, but we had never a chance to discuss it.
Yeah.
I learned yesterday night. I prepared some slides after the party, and I realized that you have a part in northern and northern east in India, where you have a high prevalence. So that's what I learned from the literature. But then it's very difficult in India because you don't know, you know, you have even some areas where you don't have so much celiac. They claimed you have really in this northern part high prevalence, higher than 1%. And so sometimes it's difficult to find. I would like to be honest, and even it's better every time you can improve your diagnostics because you have a lot of infectious diseases here. We have to find out if they could influence. So from our opinion, not, but we have to know, and we are very happy. And even it's very difficult, we ask everybody for non-celiac gluten sensitive patients. It's very difficult because how you want to pick them and what is the criteria to get them. At the moment, it's very difficult. For celiac, we know exactly with the TTG new generation, you pick them up 2 years earlier. That's why we did even a lot of studies to prove this concept. Yeah, and the benefit is only if you pick them up earlier. Later on, if they are systemic and you know it's a celiac, there's no benefit, to be honest with you.
Excuse me.
Sorry.
Yeah? Since you're using both IgA and IgG subclasses in your new epitope,
yeah.
Have you done a comparative sensitivity with TTGA and deamidated gliadin G? Because in the IgA class, TTG is supposed to be more sensitive, and in the deamidated gliadin.
I don't want to make it so boring. I can tell. We did in the last 12 years a lot of studies. I can, if you want, I can send you a lot of studies that we did and publications.
It is more sensitive than the combined sensitivity of both TTG and TTG.
To be honest, there's no more sensitive kit than neobitope with a high specificity than the CeliCheck. And even DGP, you can really forget it. And the nice thing is now other people tell it because there's a lady from Hungary. She did a study with 2,000 children, and she's publishing this now, and she was presenting in Dresden on the international congresses, and she was presenting this on the ICDS and so on. And the ESFAGAN in Essen was last time in Greece. She presents the same, and there was ongoing studies, and definitely the best, I can tell it really, the best sensitivity specificity is the CELI check, and for screening for sure, so that you don't oversee any patient. But by the way, even you can save cost. I learned in Spain in this big hospital, they save with this method every year 150,000 euros using the CELI check as a screening tool. I was surprised, and he sent me all the calculation, what they don't do. They don't no longer the IgE deficiency, they do other tests not. And he proposed to the hospital how much this department now saving was 150,000. But I have to say the guy do a lot of celiac testing.
Do you use a separate conjugate for IgE and IgG?
Yeah, we have even, now we have three kits. One is a Czech, and then you have separate IgA and IgG. So how we do it, how we even did the studies. We every time compare G, A with the combined. But I can give you, really, no problem. Last year we published 27 articles, but not only for studies, even about the research, about pattern mechanism and so on. If you want, I can give you my email address and you can get it.
Dr. Mathias, there are several pediatric patients, yeah, in which we clinically suspect that the patients might be suffering from celiac disease, but when we do TTGA, it is negative, absolutely negative.
Yeah.
What is your recommendation for those patients? And there's another subset of patients who are clinically looking like celiac disease, but the tests are borderline negative. So what's your recommendation for those patients?
I showed you CELI-check. It's really true, because the neobiotope, it's a different antigen, you know. It's and if you look in the pattern mechanism, I have even pictures about pattern mechanism, but I changed it yesterday because of the practical approach of this Congress. You know, if you remember the paper from Professor Schuppan, when it was in, not in Nature, it was in, no, I think in Nature Medicine, when he showed the pattern mechanism, he showed the lumina propria, that the peptides going through, the enzyme is there. And the first what he showed was they doing complexes. Even Professor Schuppan, I have a slide, I hide it only. He described complexes. But then he present at the end that they only produce TDG2. And if I give a complex in the mice, for example, I get against the complex, or take other example, take the nucleosomes. How you get dsDNA antibodies? It's not dsDNA antibodies that you can give in the mice and then you expect to give dsDNA antibodies. If you give nucleosomes, you get antibodies against nucleosomes, you get antibodies against dsDNA, you get antibody against histone. So, and I think the complex is the same, because my hypothesis, what I every time told, the first antibody is a complex. Then you have molecular mimicry and the antibody is going, and then you get later on against TDG, against DGPs, against this kind of processed antigens, but it's later, because first they present the complex. But some years before, nobody believed that the complex will be presented. In 2015, the group on solid is very strong in celiac. You have to check his paper. He is the first one, he describes that this complex will present it to the B cells. So, and that's a
in case of borderline negative, do you feel that there's any use of repeat testing after, say, 6 months?
Sorry, can you repeat it?
Is there any use of doing repeat tests in case of borderline negative after 6 months? Is there any
use? You can. We have some studies like this. So,
yes.
First of all, I believe that you will find the children positive in CELI check. So, and if you, after a while, I cannot say 6 months, but after a while you will find positive. The problem is we never get the patient so early. We try so many studies, but you don't know. We start now a family study. It's very funny, because a family was coming in our institute, and because of Professor Lerner and me, they asked us for celiac. The whole family eats in 3 years gluten-free diet, because of the son is a celiac patient. So that's clear. They have the diagnosis and so on, but now they got a baby. So even we start the study, but okay, they got a baby. So, and then they want to know if they're doing something wrong. And so, and the nice thing was the parents, even they didn't know if they're celiac or not, they stick to the same gluten-free diet. So the only antibody that we found was in the boy, he was confirmed celiac, was microbial transglutaminase neoepitopes. So I expect that he eats something that triggers these antibodies because it was class IgG. And so there's even a switch in the classes. In the beginning you find IgA. Then after a while it moves to IgG, and it's the same then with the antibody types. The first is neoepitopes, later on TTG, DGP will work. So I told you, if you know the patient, if it's systemic and it's classified, you don't need the neoepitopes longer. So that means even you don't need tissue transglutaminase. But the benefit is early. And this was a problem to launch the kit in the beginning, to be honest, like Stan McMillan, they said, oh, you have too much high positivity. But think about one point. The HLA classes is for me the limit. So the HLA classes you have up to 30%. So the truth is some between 0.5% and, in my opinion, between 30. And I think that some of the gluten sensitivity they have, they claim 10% will become celiac. And we don't know the HLA classes at the moment or whatever is related, but we need more to know about this. But definitely, why? It's every time fascinating, because it's the only autoimmune disease that I know where you take from the enzyme the substrate. You take the substrate, you give him no longer gluten, and the autoimmune disease disappears.
I'm sorry, sir. Really short of time. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. I think we can take the discussion in the next session. Can we have a round of applause for you?
I think I'll try and make up for the time. So purely talking of our perspective of this test, which has been there for a couple of years, and with little data from India, but from whatever I have from literature, I'll talk about this. So just coming to the bare basics, we often in our practice have patients with abdominal pain, discomfort, diarrhea, constipation, not uncommon. And the question is it irritable bowel syndrome, IBS, or is it inflammatory bowel disease? And I often find people using these terms interchangeably, not quite knowing what each one is, but they're completely different entities, though they may present in similar manner with similar set of symptoms. Now, when we talk of inflammatory bowel disease, basically we are referring to ulcerative colitis, Crohn's disease, these are the two main, and then you have an overlap and indeterminate kind of colitis, which all comes under inflammatory bowel disease. This is far more common, but it is not that we do not see inflammatory bowel disease, and the management of both these conditions is completely different, the approach is different, and therefore it's important to differentiate the two. When we talk of irritable bowel syndrome, it's basically a functional bowel disorder, very common, seen in up to 20% of the population, in the young population. In India, we seem to see many more males affected by this compared to the West, where it's more of females. And there are these Rome 3 criteria which keep getting updated, but basically it tells us that it's a functional disorder, so you have to have abdominal pain. In the absence of abdominal pain, we do not diagnose irritable bowel syndrome, and along with abdominal pain, there should be changes in the stool frequency or consistency. It should be for at least 3 days a month in the last 3 months. Onset of symptoms has to be there for at least 6 months, and it should be associated with at least two of the following: that the symptoms like pain improve with defecation, onset of pain coincides with changes in stool frequency. For example, the patient will say, when I get pain, I have a loose stool. Okay, so there's a change in frequency with the pain, which is not uncommon. All of us have faced such situations, but that doesn't mean that we have IBS. You have to have a period of 6 months of symptoms for you to say it is IBS. And onset of symptoms may be also associated with change in the form of stool. So it's not only the frequency, but the form. So it's a loose stool, it's a more frequent stool. So then you say that patient has irritable bowel syndrome. So what is the important thing? When you have a patient coming with pain, diarrhea, how do you say that this is an IBS or whether it is an inflammatory bowel disease? So we look for what is called alarm symptoms. So in a patient who presents above the age of 50, who has fever associated with the symptoms, weight loss, has a family history of a GI cancer, or he has a diarrhea which does not respond to usual medication, or he has associated GI bleeding. Typically in irritable bowel syndrome, we do not have GI bleed unless it gets complicated by piles and fissures, when you can have bleeding, but presenting with GI bleed, very important symptom, very important history. Ask the patient whether he gets up in the middle of the night with symptoms. If there are nocturnal symptoms, this is an organic problem and it is not irritable bowel syndrome. So no patient of irritable bowel syndrome gets up in the middle of the night to pass a stool. And of course, depending on physical findings, based on this alarm symptoms, if any of these are present, we are kind of ruling out irritable bowel syndrome and thinking of other problems. And then we have various tests which are available to help differentiate the two. Now, talking of inflammatory bowel disease, as I said, you have the Crohn's disease and you have ulcerative colitis. The two usually typically present a peak, again, young age. So like you have IBS in the young age group, the inflammatory bowel disease also peaks in the similar age group. So this does not help us differentiate. Crohn's disease, they can come, as I said, there's a rectal bleeding, there's weight loss. These two will not be seen in IBS. And you may have various associated problems, like you may have arthritis, uveitis, or skin problems like pyoderma gangrenosum, which is diagnostic of IBD. I'll not really go into the details of two. Just remember that Crohn's disease can occur anywhere from the mouth to the anus, anywhere in the GI tract, whereas ulcerative colitis occurs only in the colon. That's the first difference. Ulcerative colitis almost always involves the left side of the colon, whereas you may have Crohn's disease affecting only the right side of the colon. For us, the differentiation is not between Crohn's and ulcerative colitis in clinical practice, because the differences are pretty straightforward. I'll not really go into that. But for us, the challenge is to differentiate Crohn's disease from tuberculosis, because tuberculosis also is seen in the ileocecal area where Crohn's is most common. Again, I said I'll not go into the details of this, but we'll focus on the talk, which is use of calprotectin from our viewpoint. Treatment of inflammatory bowel disease, you use drugs like mesalamine, steroids, immunosuppressive drugs, sometimes surgery, and we also have biologicals like infliximab. Diagnosis is based on acute phase reactions. I have not mentioned CRP here, but CRP is very important. Stool routine. And finally, we need a endoscopy or a colonoscopy or a sigmoidoscopy and take biopsies to give us the diagnosis of inflammatory bowel disease. So this becomes our gold standard for diagnosis. And these are the various appearances you can see. You can have what is called pseudopolyps, linear ulcers. This is a typical appearance of ulcerative colitis. This is typically Crohn's, and you can and these are the pseudopolyps. So, but the problem with colonoscopy is invasive. It's not very pleasant. The preparation for colonoscopy is extremely unpleasant. Patients don't like it at all. And having a disease like inflammatory bowel disease, which is going to last a lifetime, it is not going to go away. And to be subjected to repeat colonoscopies again and again is not going to be a very pleasant experience. Needs intravenous sedation and has been associated with complications, especially in the setting of IBD. These patients are known to have a higher risk of perforation when performed in the active stage. So these are the downsides of a colonoscopy. And often when patients like irritable bowel syndrome undergo a colonoscopy, they are normal. So, you know, you're often not getting a good yield. You're subjecting 60% of patients to colonoscopy who have normal findings. So what do we do? What is an ideal test? It has to be simple. It has to be quick, sensitive, and specific. At the same time, it should be non-invasive and not expensive. So what do we have? Is fecal calprotectin the answer? especially for differentiating irritable bowel syndrome from inflammatory bowel disease. So what is this calprotectin? It's a protein with a molecular weight of 36 kilodalton. It belongs to the family, S100 family of zinc binding proteins. Basically, it's found in granulocytes, neutrophils, and it was first described in 1980, where 60% of the cytoplasm is made up of calprotectin. It's called calprotectin because cal is because it binds to calcium, and protectin because it has antimicrobial properties. It's easily measurable in stools. And various synonyms have been used for the same protein, calprotectin. I'll not really go into the details, but it's an important marker of intestinal inflammation as shown here. The various other markers like lactoferrin also has been used in literature. So whenever you have the mucosal layer of the intestine which is disrupted, it stimulates neutrophils which come and release this calprotectin in the lumen of the bowel, and it does not get destroyed in the bowel lumen and therefore can be measured in the stool. So this is an important marker of intestinal inflammation, and it can be detected in various body fluids as well, also in the plasma. The levels have been found to correlate with disease activity. The levels may remain stable in the stool for up to 7 days, but that's an upper limit. Up to 3 days would be more realistic. Day-to-day variation in a fecal calprotectin levels have been found, and newborns have been found to have higher levels than in adults, and one should be aware of this. We do see infantile inflammatory bowel disease also. It's not common, but they reach normal adult values by 5 years of age. So this fact should be known that in children. Now this is a study looking at children 1 to 18 months of age, and look at this. I mean, a normal level in a child 1 to 3 months of age is 400, which is, you know, a very, I would say, a pathological level for an adult. And it goes down as the age progresses. So just to know the fact that calprotectins are high in children, as I mentioned, it comes from the granulocyte. 60% of the cytoplasm is this. It's also found in kidney tubules, skin, and squamous epithelium. It is secreted in the colon and is therefore found in much higher levels than what is found in the blood. The granulocytes secrete this into the lumen, and also the microbes in the lumen activate epithelial cells to produce calprotectin. As I said, it's resistant to degradation. Now this is important, that how is it measured? So there are various assays. We have the ELISA assay, which would take about 4 hours measuring this test, and you need an entire batch or whatever, 35, 40 samples to be analyzed before you get a value. So you know you have to wait to have so many samples to analyze by ELISA. You know these assays better than I do, but we have a chemiluminescent assay which uses a monoclonal antibody. Which is available within 35 minutes, and here you don't need to take the entire batch. It can be done individually, like the one which is available from Diasorin. So basically, various assays are available, and it is now possible to do individual tests and get the results as soon as possible. There are other what is called the point of care assays, which are qualitative assays. So it just tells you, it doesn't give you a value. It may just give you positive, negative, what is called a qualitative assay. And there are semi-quantitative assays where you see a control line over here, and based on that you decide whether you, how many lines you are seeing, what would be the likely corresponding calprotectin level. This is kind of a crude way, but it is there, available nevertheless. So now I look at studies as to how calprotectin levels in the stool have been used in various clinical settings. So this is a study which looked at the calprotectin levels in patients with ulcerative colitis at different times of the day, whether it was important to give the first stool sample of the day to measure the calprotectin level, and they found that not necessarily so. So this study showed that you could use any sample in the day to measure calprotectin. And this is one which looks at various conditions which can cause a high calprotectin level. So I want to emphasize that calprotectin level does not diagnose inflammatory bowel disease because any cause of gut inflammation. I had a patient recently who with amoebiasis who had a high calprotectin level. It has been described to be high in patients with intestinal tuberculosis as well. So any inflammation of the bowel can cause high calprotectin levels, and they have even malignancies, they have found colorectal malignancies to be associated with high calprotectin levels. So also in some patients with celiac disease and microscopic colitis. But it has great value in differentiating an inflammatory cause like all these from non-inflammatory cause like irritable bowel syndrome. And that is the clinical value for us. And this is a list of various conditions where calprotectin has been found to be high. So various kind types of infective diarrhea, malignancies, even non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs can affect the bowel and will cause high values. And so there's a whole list available. I'll not go into this. Just to emphasize the point that it is inflammation which differentiates it. So these are the studies which have looked at calprotectin levels in irritable bowel syndrome. And it has been found that even in IBS, the levels may be high, though not the level of rise in calprotectin is not much. And I'll discuss the what are the significant levels. Now, these were ELISA tests, which this study looked at the levels in inflammatory bowel disease, comparing calprotectin to the colonoscopy findings. And as you can see, if you take a cutoff of 50 micrograms in the stool, then you have a very high sensitivity, which means that you are unlikely to miss any cases of IBD. But if you take a cutoff of 100 micrograms, then the specificity is better than a cutoff. That means whatever you test is going to be IBD and not a false positive. So you have to keep a kind of a balance between the two as to what you're looking at. Are you looking at the general population where you are testing this, where you would like a low cutoff? Or are you looking at a population which comes to us, which is already a referred population, where you would prefer a higher cutoff to pick up these patients? Now, again, this study was a meta-analysis which looked at various inflammatory markers, CRP, ESR, fecal lactoferrin, and calprotectin. And they found that if you add CRP to fecal calprotectin, then your yield for diagnosing inflammatory bowel disease goes up. And if you have a value less than 40, then it almost certainly rules out inflammatory bowel disease. So that's an important finding. This was in patients with Crohn's disease where they correlated it with histology and they found a very good correlation. The higher the histological index, the higher were the levels of fecal calprotectin. This was correlating it with the endoscopy severity score of Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. And this is important. When we talk of Crohn's disease, there are two broad categories. It's either an inflammatory subtype or you have the stricturing subtype where you have more of fibrosis. So it is with the inflammatory phase of Crohn's disease that fecal calprotectin correlates well, and that is understandably so, the way I described on what it is based. Whereas in ulcerative colitis, it was found that in those with left-sided and extensive disease, the levels correlate better. What about, as I said, Crohn's can occur anywhere from the mouth to the anus. What about correlation with small bowel disease? The correlation was much better with colonic Crohn's disease compared to ileal Crohn's disease. And it was in the ileal disease where you could get more false negative results. That means if you have a patient of Crohn's who has only ileal disease, you may get normal calprotectin levels. Okay, so that's an important kind of way. You cannot rule out Crohn's if your calprotectin levels are normal and the ileum is involved. Now again, this is looking at but on the other hand, we have studies like this where they looked at MRE. So there are various ways. You have blood markers, ESR and CRP, where you find CRP is a better. There was an Indian study published last year. Somebody asked about Indian studies in Indian Journal of Gastroenterology from Hinduja Hospital, where they found that fecal calprotectin level correlated very well with CRP but not with ESR. So CRP they found, and there was this study which showed that a combination of CRP and fecal calprotectin was much better than calprotectin alone. So you look at various modes of investigation to look at or determine the severity of inflammation. So one is the blood markers. Second is you have the fecal calprotectin. Then you have the endoscopic findings and the scores. You have the histological scores. You have CT and MR scores. So there's a never-ending list of various inflammatory scores you could have to find out the severity of the disease. So this study looked at the MR findings, and they found that it correlated very well, especially for ileal disease. See, why do we do MR? We do it mainly for ileal disease or perianal disease, because the colon is accessible to the colonoscope. But looking at the small bowel is not so easy enteroscopically. So you look at MR for the small bowel especially, and they found that there was a good correlation. Similarly, looking at the small bowel endoscopically, that is through a capsule, they found a good correlation. And so that was correlation with activity and inflammation. Now what about response to treatment? They found that if one had a normal calprotectin 2 months or 8 weeks after having having started treatment, and the calprotectin at 8 weeks came back to normal, it predicted a complete endoscopic response. So you could correlate it with the response endoscopically. And on the other hand, if it had not come back to normal, it meant that there is no complete response of the treatment. It also correlates or predicts response to monoclonal antibodies like TNF antagonists like infliximab, which has been used in the treatment of Crohn's disease. This again study looked at patients who required a colectomy or who are non-responsive to steroids or biologicals, and they found that in this subset, the fecal calprotectin levels were much higher, again correlating with the severity of the disease. What about remission? Does it correlate with remission? Yes, if you have a calprotectin level below 50, some would say below 40, this study looked at it and found below 56, you can predict remission. So lower the values in the range less than, I would say, 50 to 60, one would say that the patient is in remission. It also does predict mucosal healing. Again, the same thing, patient is in remission. So you can actually say that if your calprotectin is less than 50, there is unlikely to be any active mucosal disease. What about a patient who is maintaining remission, and then you are just following up this patient with calprotectin levels, and then suddenly you find the calprotectin level go up? Does it predict relapse of the disease? And yes, there has been a meta-analysis to look at this, and they have found that 14-fold to 18-fold rise in various studies for both ulcerative colitis and Crohn's did predict a risk of relapse. What about recurrence post-operatively? Does it predict recurrence? And yes, more than 80% of Crohn's disease would require surgery within 10 years. And we have, it has again been shown, like medical therapy, within 8 weeks after surgery also, the fecal calprotectin levels tend to come down to normal. And a third of these would have a recurrence. And looking at the studies, various studies, they have found that post-op recurrence and fecal calprotectin levels correlate very well. So if you have a level more than 100, it has a sensitivity of 89% and 58% specificity. So sensitivity is much better than specificity. So any patient post-op also should have ideally a level less than 50 to say that the patient is in remission. Now what about pouchitis? I don't know if you're aware of pouchitis. A pouch, basically, one of the common surgeries for ulcerative colitis is where you remove the entire large bowel and you anastomose the ileum to the anal canal, and you create a pouch of the ileum to give it a function of the rectal reservoir. So it functions like a rectal reservoir, which will hold back the stool and reduce the stool frequency over a period of time. Now this pouch, which is made from the ileum, also can get inflamed after surgery, and it presents like an inflammatory bowel disease. It presents with pain, diarrhea, and sometimes bleeding. So it mimics IBD. You've removed the entire colon in the ulcerative colitis, but you're still having a patient who can have pain, fever, diarrhea, bleeding. And this situation is referred to as pouchitis. So can you have a patient who's had a pouch surgery, follow up with fecal calprotectin levels? And again, there were studies on this, and they found that it correlates fairly well, and you can predict pouchitis with an inflamed pouch from a non-inflamed pouch with the help of fecal calprotectin. And these are the studies looking at that. What about children? Is there any role? Yes, they have found that there's a fairly good correlation of various indices in children, the pediatric Crohn's disease index, etc., to correlate well with fecal calprotectin levels. Similarly, in ulcerative colitis, it correlated fairly well. And the important point which was made is that in children, you need a higher cutoff value to diagnose, to be more specific, otherwise the specificity goes down. So you need a cutoff level of 100 compared to 50 in adults. So I'd like to summarize by saying that fecal calprotectin is a useful non-invasive test to differentiate an organic diarrhea from a functional diarrhea, that is an inflammatory bowel disease, which consists of ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease, versus irritable bowel syndrome. It correlates well. Having diagnosed inflammatory bowel disease, it correlates well with the disease activity, especially the inflammatory disease activity, with response to therapy, whether there is a relapse, remission, and also with pouchitis and post-operative recurrences. It is therefore an adjunctive test for us. If I have a patient with chronic diarrhea referred to me, I would like to do a fecal calprotectin just to be sure. If I'm not sure, if it's a classical IBS, probably not. But if I'm not sure that there is a small chance that this could be an inflammatory bowel disease, screening fecal calprotectin will help me to sieve the two. Maybe IBS on one side and all the other inflammatory pathologies on the other. The role in colorectal cancer screening is not proven, and therefore I did not really discuss this. It has been used in the pediatric population with IBD as well. And as a final slide, I'd like to show this simple algorithm that if you do a fecal calprotectin, if it's less than 50 microgram per gram in a patient who comes with chronic diarrhea, it's very likely to be irritable bowel syndrome. If it's between 50 and 150, it could be other causes of gut inflammation, like an infection, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. As I said, I've also seen it in TB and amoebiasis. In this population, I would repeat, because what you would do is you'll probably head for a colonoscopy in these patients, or if you feel it's very unlikely to be IBD, this makes more sense. Just repeat the calprotectin after 2 or 3 weeks. If it is coming back to normal, then it's more likely. Or if it's some inflammation like an amoebiasis which has been taken care of, it will likely to be come back to normal. If it remains high, then one should proceed to a colonoscopy. And if you have a patient with a more than 150 value, then you should think of an organic disease like inflammatory bowel disease and straight away proceed to colonoscopy. And with this, I'd like to end my talk. Thank you very much.
Madam, in a patient with inflammatory bowel disease who has been treated, who is in remission, and you are following up the patient, the fecal calprotectin comes high. So at that point of time, what about the clinical features of the patient in your experience?
Yes, of course. You'll know by that.
Achha.
See, I would... Now, this is not a very clear-cut, guidelines are not there. So we go by clinical, but time and again we are told that you may have endoscopic relapse without the patient having clinical symptoms.
Okay.
So how do you predict? And therefore, there are so many studies correlating endoscopic recurrence and fecal calprotectin, because quite a few of these patients, there may be a lag between the endoscopic recurrence and the patient developing clinical symptoms.
But then is the patient to be treated at that stage, or
yes,
you wait?
No, the bottom line is there should be endoscopic remission,
okay,
not clinical remission.
Okay. Thank you, madam.
Yeah. Any more questions?
Ma'am, it is seen that many of the assays which is available have different cutoff. So what about the standardization of those assays?
I don't know. I don't think there should be different cutoffs. I mean, these are the, maybe a pathologist would be able to answer
that. Yeah, I mean, it's a good question that I'm happy to help you with that information offline if you want to have a chat about that. We're, certainly our company are going through a lot of effort to, we have a monoclonal antibody, so we're going through a lot of effort to get that standardized. We can't speak for other companies, of course. It's important to get that standardization. We realize that, and we're going through a process to get there, but we're not there yet. Yeah.
That was a wonderful presentation. I just have a question. I look at biopsies, but the question is sometimes Crohn's and ulcerative colitis, when they are very active, it's very difficult to differentiate, though you say it's the gold standard at histopathology. Now, how do you look at the scalp protectin to differentiate the two?
No, you can't.
Endoscopically, also the gastroenterologist is very often confused because at times you can have UC going extending so widely up to going even up to the ileocecal junction sometimes.
What do you do then? Honestly, as I said, as a gastroenterologist, for me, it's not between UC, ulcerative colitis and Crohn's. The clinical problem is differentiating Crohn's from tuberculosis. See, I mean, there are many differences, clinical, historical differences between, and endoscopic differences between Crohn's and ulcerative. Ulcerative will almost always involve the rectum. If you have rectum not involved, it's almost certainly Crohn's. You may have only right-sided involvement in Crohn's. Ulcerative will always go upwards, so it will go from below upwards. So rectum, left colon, it may stop at the splenic fracture, what we call a left-sided colitis, or it may go all the way up to the cecum. So ulcerative colitis is a continuous disease and not a skip lesion as you see in Crohn's. Crohn's can involve any part of the gut. So if you have a mid-jejunal involvement with a stricture, this is clearly Crohn's disease. So I don't think there should be much, your clinician should give you good history and should give you good endoscopy findings to help you differentiate. And if you have granulomas, that is one thing which you will never get in ulcerative colitis, but you'll get in Crohn's.
Yeah.
But you don't get them all the time. Yeah.
Yeah. Even in Crohn's, you do not get.
Yes,
you
I
get
agree.
Is only ulcers, and you hunt sure. and hunt, you never get a granuloma. The question comes is, because after the endoscopy, the findings would be, yes, increased vascular pattern, granula, and things like that. But then biopsy leads nowhere, and the request says, yes, it's a inflammatory bowel disease. Now, how does one go about? So I was wondering if you have any clues to those.
Yeah, so the gastro, you can just say inflammatory bowel disease favors ulcerative, consistent with ulcerative, whatever terms you use, over Crohn's. So honestly, I don't think that's a problem to us.
Okay.
The problem is between TB and Crohn's.
Got it. Thank you.
I don't think the sensitivity and specificity is, I don't use it at all. There are people who use it, but I don't find it, yeah. So similarly for ulcerative, they use P-ANCA, you know. So I think these may be like supplementary, but just because ASCA is positive, I'll not label as Crohn's. Or just because P-ANCA is positive, I'll not label as ulcerative. I'll put everything together. So, you know, to answer the same question, you have to put the history. For example, bleeding is much more common in ulcerative colitis, less common in Crohn's. So, but it's not that you don't see it in Crohn's. So you have, there are scoring systems actually for each clinical symptom, endoscopic findings, you can score. So you have to actually get that out of your gastroenterologist. What is their endoscopic, view on what they find.
Thank you.
So I bring you the greetings from St. John's, Bangalore. I have been given a topic, something to do with ANCA, but I just thought I should start with a story that goes way back in 1982. It's a 28-year-old female who was lethargic, had weight loss, anorexia, arthralgia, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea. So you speak of it, all the systems looked involved in this patient. And had the patient also had dyspnea, cough, sputum, occasionally it was blood tinged. So it was a multisystemic involvement like. And that patient went to consult so-called Dr. Davis. So what did he find in this patient? That is quite strange. The patient was anemic, had a total count something like 40,000, ESR was 100 millimeters, so they were definitely increased. But strangely, urine had proteinuria. It had microscopic hematuria was positive and there were granular casts. So this made the patient, the Dr. Davis to take a chest x-ray, and he didn't find it anything specific. And he did routine tests at that time, that was ANA, etc., and they found that everything was negative. So when it's multisystemic, the first thing one would think is rule out an autoimmune process, and he found that ANA, everything was negative. So he waited for 5 years, not finding a cause for this kind of a condition. He found 7 more patients like this, similar symptoms. And then what did he do? He did a renal biopsy, and because it mandated, there was microscopic hematuria, there was proteinuria, and there were granular casts, so indicated a renal biopsy. And what did he find? That was 40 to 70% of the glomeruli were all affected with crescents. So they were crescents, and this is what we find is the crescent looking here with fibrin, and that was positive with immunofluorescence. And this, of the 7 patients, 5 were having this necrotizing so-called crescentic glomerulonephritis. So this patient had lung involvement, had kidney involvement, had weight loss, had GI symptoms, etc., etc. So he was wondering what to do with this patient. And he found that all patients, that is his 7 patients, had in their serum a factor that stained the cytoplasm of neutrophils with immunofluorescence. So when he did his ANA, he did realize that there were something staining, and they were predominantly IgG. But when he was doing his animal studies, they didn't stain the rodent WBCs. So that prompted him to bring out this entity so-called ANCA, anti-neutrophilic cytoplasmic antibodies. So it was first published in BMJ in 1982 by Dr. Davis. So our first case of, that is, or introduced, ANCA was introduced in 1982, and it came on to say that the glomerular lesions in these cases were morphologically indistinguishable. He didn't know what that entity he could call it as. He knew that they were similar to microscopic PAN or polyarthritis nodosa. And by then he had examined about 5,000 sera to answer his 7 patient story, and he found that none of them had this disease. So he knew it was something very, very unique, and that he thought that it could be a chance association with so-called an infection, Ross virus, a river virus infection then. And then that became the ANCA. And to take you to this story of ANCA unfolded, I thought I'll just introduce you how and where and we look and read ANCA. So it all starts with the major blood vessel aorta, with the spectrum of vessels that we have, which could be a small vessel vasculitis, which involves right from here to the extent, or it could be purely large vessel or medium sized. What we encounter very commonly is the small vessel vasculitis. And if you look at this, what constitutes the majority of the vasculitis is these HS purpura or microscopic polyangiitis. And very strangely, or we love to read, is the Wegener's granulomatosis and Churg-Strauss syndrome. So these are the 3 conditions which we probably worry about when we look at ANCA and the vasculitis. The so-called Chapel Hill Consensus Conference in 1994 classified the vasculitis in this fashion. But what we would concentrate are these. because essentially HS and essential cryoglobulinic, they are all very unique and they are easily diagnosable. But what is important are these three conditions because of a high mortality rate that goes with these conditions. So coming to the Wegeners in 1939, the so-called Dr. Wegener, he found a strange rhinogenous granulomatosis. He found that there was involvement of the nose and the upper respiratory atract with participation of the arterial system as well as the kidney involvement. And he brought out his first paper in way back in 1939. This is a case of very strange. This is a pathologist, but he was involved with the Nazi criminals. So-called, and for his work, the achievement that he had, the American Association awarded him with many. But when they found out that he was involved with the Nazi crime, his awards were stripped off. And the American and the so-called the association of the poor community, which were very proud to be calling this condition as Wegeners, they didn't want it to be named anymore as Wegeners, and they wanted it to be called as granulomatosis with polyangiitis. It's called as GPA for short, and it is so-called from 2007. So we no more call this as Wegeners anymore. Giving him a probably having associated himself with the Nazis. So that's the story that goes with Dr. Wegener, the pathologist. Now, this is a beautiful scenario where we compare the various types of vasculitis. You have a green and a blue, and in between is an area where we have no anchor bodies. Now, we need to see that on one side we have the microscopic polyangiitis. The second one is the Wegener so-called, now being replaced with granulomatosis with polyangiitis. You see that these two are strongly positive so-called with anchor. So-called, if we divide them into C and P anchor, and the rest are all with the other type. So I just wanted to introduce this diagram to you and show you, take you on to further. So when is anchor ordered? Is whenever any one of these symptoms which appear to be multisystemic, we more often do it, especially when there is involvement of the lung and the kidney, and of course skin could have nervous system involvement. And especially one looks at peripheral, the extremities with vasculitis, one thought should always be towards anchor, and along with the skin biopsy, one goes to do an IF on it as well as an anchor. So the anchor antibodies against the neutrophilic cytoplasmic antigens, especially the azurophilic granules, are most often targeted to two antigens. One is MPO, which we call it is the myeloperoxidase. The other one is PR3 or proteinase 3. This is detected by two methods, immunofluorescence by indirect method, where we use the normal human neutrophils as the culture on which you have your patient's serum being added on, or you use the ELISA method when there is specifically look for PR3 or MPO. So the anchor report is done with a dilution of 1 in 10, that's very important. And when you type it, you say is anchor negative, or when positive, is it C anchor or P anchor? Sometimes you may get atypical C anchor, atypical anchor if you are not very definite. And it could be graded from 1 plus to 3 plus to show the intensity of the antibodies. Now this is a picture taken to show a pattern where we have neutrophils, where cytoplasm is strongly fluorescing. It's very granular and it is fluorescing with a halo, that is the dark point, it's corresponding to the lobes of the neutrophil. So I liken this to the lady's finger, very easy to remember, that's how I put it up across to anyone who reads it, the cut surface of a lady's finger. It's exactly like this, and this pattern is nothing but the C anchor pattern. This is the ethanol fixed wells and shows that there are antibodies to PR3. So this is the C ANCA pattern. Sometimes we see the primate liver and this is the buffy coat. Now we have, when we have this kind of a presentation, when we have neutrophils, the lobes are being stained, it looks like the entire entire nucleus is stained three-dimensionally, and this is compared to the berries, this is how it looks, and I call that as the P ANCA pattern, which is very characteristic against the MPO. So sometimes we have this kind of a presentation which is very, very thick and distinct around the membrane, so called the membranous pattern, but a little clearer in the center, but not like that you saw it in the C ANCA pattern. And this is the P ANCA atypical. And if you don't have that much of fluorescence, neither the density in the center, we call that atypical C ANCA. So it could be reading that ANCA by four-well method, wherein we have a HEP2 in the top left corner, the primate liver, with formalin, formaldehyde fixed or ethanol fixed. These are the four wells. Or it could be a three-well biochip where you have HEP2 cells with granulocytes in the upper left hand, nothing here, with formaldehyde and ethanol fixed. Now, depending on this, we go on to read the next sets of slides. Sorry, it's all got displaced, I think, in our presentation. So we have HEP2 being zero. There's nothing to stain here, but you have your formaldehyde that is fixed is showing a C ANCA pattern with ethanol fixed, also C ANCA pattern, so it becomes C ANCA pattern. So when we have a biochip like this with C ANCA pattern positive and this with granulocytes, we confirm that it is C ANCA positive only. So when we have HEP2 negative with C ANCA pattern in formalin fixed and with the P ANCA pattern that is here, I think it is P ANCA pattern with the MPO pattern. It's all gone heavy, I don't know. I'll just take it to the next. Now to compare the C ANCA pattern and the P ANCA pattern, we have, sorry, this is very clear. So formalin fixed one differentiates between the P ANCA and the C ANCA pattern. They both have to be C ANCA, but the ethanol fixed one, where you get the lady's finger like pattern, differentiates from the cherry pattern, which you get it in the ethanol fixed. So the C ANCA and the P ANCA pattern makes this, this slide makes it very clear. So to go for the target antigen for C ANCA is protease 3, whereas the target antigen for P ANCA is MPO. It could be others, elastase and cathepsin, but we do not matter, we do not much give importance to these. But the question is, why in ethanol fixed slides do we get this kind of a pattern with C ANCA and different with P ANCA? The question is, with ethanol fixed slides, what happens is the ethanol makes the antigens, the MPO, come out of the, diffuse out of the granules to the nuclear membrane. And that makes it very, very strictly adherent to the granules. Whereas in formalin, you get only cytoplasmic staining. So now going back to this situation where we have ANCA negative, I don't know. There's something wrong with the, so this is C ANCA pattern, granulocytoplasmic fluorescence. This is the snow drifting pattern that you see in the granules going out from the membrane, and this is the typical ANCA pattern. So what is the drawbacks of the ANCA testing that we have seen in the labs is not always well standardized. They are not always done with controls. The sensitivity and specificity we have found that varies from lab to lab. They are not graded from 1 to 3 plus, so we do not know the intensity. And many often this is not done with ELISA, so there are no reference values as such for normal. So the best way that this to go ahead with ANCA is to do a clinical path correlation, and it has to be done. And hence the indirect immunofluorescence is very sensitive, good. It's used as a screening test, but must do an ELISA for specificity for PR3 or MPO. So it helps to determine the amount of antibody present and hence the titer. So looking at the clinical applications. So when you do immunofluorescence and ELISA, your positive predictive value goes up to as much as 88%. But when you say negative test, sometimes it comes to us, is it truly negative? Does it need a tissue biopsy, or you are happy with only ANCA? Or should you have titers, in that case, what do we do? And what is the parameter to guide the clinician for his treatment? So this is a table which talks about the PR3, that is C-ANCA and the P-ANCA values against granulomatosis with polyangiitis. You see that the C-ANCA is 70% positive in the so-called granulomatosis with polyangiitis, that is vaginosis. But it is only 25% P-ANCA can be positive versus 70% in posthumous glomerulonephritis. So we could have both P and C-ANCA positive of varying percentages in these diseases. So nothing is truly specific for a disease. And it is said that the P-ANCA associated diseases could be, as just thought about in UC, you could have it in 76% of the cases, where Crohn's is only 7%. So I have seen some people use this criteria to differentiate the two, but can't be very sure. So when it comes to the nomenclature, when we have vasculitis, should we use the word leukocytoclastic? Or should it be ANCA-associated vasculitis? Or is it a limited diseases with no vasculitis? So in practice, I think clinical differentiation between these various diseases that have been shown here is difficult because of the overlaps. But the treatment does change the intensity, the way you treat with chemo, with cytotoxic drugs would also matter. Now, looking at this, this green part is the one which is MPO ANCA, that is P ANCA pattern. You see that you could have any of these conditions having this. But C ANCA is more often seen in microscopic polyangiitis and in granulomatosis with polyangiitis. So when you have C ANCA, these are the two conditions that you need to worry about. So we know that ANCA can cause disease. But the question is, what causes ANCA? There's a lot been discussed, lot have been written, there are 101 articles, but it just boils down to three aspects. There's theory of molecular mimicry, which is the cause for autoimmune disease. There's something called as apoptosis, which is defective in these neutrophils, and a lot depends on our environment and the drugs and whatever the patient takes it additionally. This is a picture wherein it shows that you have your B cells which are dysregulated, and you have your T cells also which foster autoimmunity, and you have your neutrophils with your ANCA bodies sticking onto them, and when they come in contact with anti-eutotypic response to this kind of, you have your ANCA antibodies being produced. These are your blood vessels. You have your blood vessels lined by these endothelial cells. So these neutrophils, with so many of their antigens sticking onto their surface, by activation by the C3, there's a lot of priming happening. There's a lot of conversion to C5A. That is the complement C5A. And we know that when C5A comes in, you have your chemotaxis, you have a lot of intrusion, your vasculitis, the blood vessels open up, you have your extravasation. So the whole process depends on your neutrophils, and that in turn is a lot dependent on this NPO and PR3 genes, which are affected by the antibodies which stick onto them. So the evolution of this disease depends on four things. Is there a genetic predisposition? Is it that some group of people are more affected? Is there a polymorphism or a genetic disbalance that causes this kind of an immune response? Or is there a loss of tolerance, and that there is a lot of autoantibody production like the way we see in SLE? Or is it the environment factors? Maybe it's the infections, it could be viral, or it could be some of the bacterial. They all cause an acute injury, the neutrophils and the monocytes, and that results in the, you saw the cascade that in the previous slide, there is orchestration of the so-called stimulated by injury by the T cells and the macrophage, and in turn on the neutrophils. So now, to satisfy the therapy for this ANCAR disease, what is to be standardized today? What is called as the induction therapy, the maintenance therapy with steroids, or when would you see immune suppression, or would you subject the patient for plasmapheresis so that you could take away the antibodies depending on the severity of the patient, especially when his lungs and the kidney are affected, is a lot being discussed in the articles. And what is given more importance is that 90% of these patients die within 2 years, usually due to respiratory failure if left untreated. So severe, but they could be so subtle, and the patient may go undetected. And that treatment has converted, there's a statement that I picked up from the article, it says that acutely fatal disease is now made into a chronic relapsing disorder, and that it's accumulating morbidity. So you're just lengthening his lifespan, but his quality of life is very poor. And hence, he looks that as for successful treatment, vasculitis must be recognized and treated as early as possible so that you avoid permanent scar, meaning avoid involvement of the liver, of the lung and the kidney. So looking to the future, what is the biology of these conditions? Is there, how do you avoid relapse? How do you bring in remission? Do you, this new protocol that has been used, rituximab, is being tried out, avoiding methotrexate. And there is something called as an activity disease scoring, like the way we do for lupus nephritis. We have an activity and chronicity index. So similarly, it is done for the Birmingham vasculitis activity score. You have a damage index. So a lot of new interests have been brought into this kind of vasculitis. And I think ANCA plays a very, very important role in identifying these conditions. So looking into the future, probably we, as reading the slides, helping in the diagnosis, help the patient to have, where his immunosuppression could be tailored. We could probably, with titers, help him to say that whether he's in remission or is he improving. So where are we is that Davis in 1982, he described ANCA. In 1985, the ANCA was discovered in Vegnus. Then we had a second international workshop on ANCA in 89, where PR3 and MPO were discovered. The pattern C and P were discovered in 1989 after 7 years when Davis et al. Found out there was ANCA. Now we have clinical trials where rituximab is used and with or without steroids and cyclophosphamide. So it seems, it looks as if we are on the right track, and probably the bottom line to look at is that immunofluorescence does help as a screening test, but ELISA is something specific and should be done along with immunofluorescence. And that's from me. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I would like to thank the APPA and the CPC Diagnostics for giving me this opportunity. I think I am an odd man out. I am going to speak on a biochemistry technique. In order to, you know, save time, I will try to skip some of my slides which give you description about the antibody structure and so on. Basically, I'm going to talk about the immunoturbidometry which is used in the biochemistry laboratories, and the CPC has now come out with a new analyzer called TurboSpec, which is a dedicated analyzer for the turbidometry. Now, if you go to your biochemistry department, there are various techniques that are used. You will, the most predominant one is the photometry, then the immunoturbidometry, nephelometry, electrophoresis, chromatography, and all the immunoassays like radioimmunoassay, ELISA, and the big daddy, the CLIA and ECL. And all these use the use of antibodies. So I don't want to bore you with the structure of antibodies and so on, the specificity and the, all the stuff we all know. So these are all the basics of the immuno, you know, any assays. And an antibody will recognize the antigen in a defined segment by use of certain changes in amino acid, you know, residues. Nowadays, you are able to produce some antibodies which are of high sensitivity. So the sensitivity or, you know, the specificity can be improved nowadays by changing certain amino acids. And there are two types of antibodies which I use. One is monoclonal and another one is a polyclonal, which again everyone knows how they are produced and so on. And if you want to construct an immunoassay, especially, you know, you have to look at various things like accurate measurement in significant concentration, that is low and high in sensitivity, and intra and inter-assay variations, the high batch consistency, and of course eco-friendliness and so on. So many of the immunoassays are discarded and only some are chosen. And the basic immunoassays fall into two categories. One is called as the homogeneous immunoassay, and the other one is called the heterogeneous immunoassay. The nephelometry and the turbidometry fall in the category of homogeneous immunoassay, where you don't have to separate the bound fraction from the free fraction. So it can be adapted into any automated system where you don't have to add any second antibody or a solid phase to separate the bound fraction from the free fraction. And for a long time, people believed that the nephelometry is considered as a superior technology, which requires a dedicated nephelometer for the analysis. And this was considered as a gold standard. But nowadays, the nephelometer is overtaken by the turbidometry, and if not superior, people believe now the turbidometry is as good as the nephelometry. Now, for a long time, people knew the use of light to pass through a solution. The light is either scattered or absorbed and reflected by the molecules present in the solution. In a solution, when an antigen and antibody along with latex particles or without latex particles present will either absorb a certain amount of light and scatter some amount of light. The scattered light, you know, gets scattered in all directions. So at various angles, the light will go. Now, if you look at the turbidimetry, if you take the incident light, if you look at the incident beam, when it passes through the, it passes through the solution, and when it comes out, that is known as the turbidence, and you know, it absorbs a certain amount of light. If you look at the two graphs, the top one is the light scattering of a 186 nanometer size particle, whereas the bottom graph is the light scattering of a 665 nanometer particle. Both are the same, you know, molecules, but the particle size differs. When you look at this, the smaller particle has a normal behavior, that is a very smooth behavior, whereas the larger particles have a somewhat erratic behavior. So from this, they realize that if you want to measure the turbidity, it is better if you take a smaller particle. So how do you take a smaller particle? If you are conjugating your antigen or the antibody with latex particles, nowadays latex particles of various sizes are available. But if you are only reacting antigen with antibody, then by controlling the time, if you say, allow the reaction to take place only for 3 or 4 minutes or 5 minutes, then only certain number of molecules will react with each other and the particle size can be small. Whereas if you allow the reaction to take place for a longer time, then the particle size will become larger. When the particle size becomes larger, then due to the sheer size of the molecule itself, the particles can get disrupted, and that can give you abnormal behavior as far as the turbidity is concerned. So this is a typical CRP graph which is used for a turbidometry, and from here you can see the bottom one, which is a smooth curve, and here you can see as the you know, size increases, the absorbance decreases. So they have sort of you know, set up an assay with a certain particle size, and with that you can make the measurement with a smooth absorbance. Now if you come to the nephelometry, the scattered light, you know, gets scattered in all directions, so the angle at which the light gets scattered is very, very important. And it has been found that 5, 10 and 20 degrees angle is very, very important for the measurement. There are two graphs shown here. The top graph is with time. This is 5 degrees, 10 degrees and 20 degrees. And the same particle, when the size becomes larger, you can see that they are, you know, behaving in a different manner. So from this again, you can conclude that in the nephelometer, the immunoreactivity function is dependent on the angle at which you make the measurement, and the smaller the particle, it is easier to measure. So you can also see that the small particles behave in a much better way rather than the larger particle where the graph is not smooth. And in the nephelometer, there are three regions. In the first region, that is from here to here, where the antibody is in excess, it is called the region of antibody excess, where there is a, you know, uniform increase. Then it comes to an area where the amount of antigen and antibody are equal, that is the region of equivalence. And then this is the region where the antigen is in present in large quantity than the antibody. So you cannot make the measurement in this region because you can see that the graph is coming down. So the, in a nephelometer, the measurement has to be made either in this region or in this region. If the measurement is made in this region, then it has to be made in a kinetic fashion, whereas here it is measured in an endpoint fashion. So from all these studies, what they have concluded is the measurement of the antigen, that is the proteins present in any solution, could be very, very conveniently measured in an accurate fashion using a turbidometry rather than a nephelometer. So the CPC has come out with a dedicated analyzer called a TurboSpec, which is, which is a tabletop analyzer which looks like this, and it has got a high precision aspiration, dispensing and mixing, and it has got dedicated system pack rack for turbidometry assays, and it has got the facility to do multi-point calibration with calibration editing facility and onboard auto serial dilution of calibrators. So if you provide a high concentration single calibrator, it will do auto dilution and perform a 5-point calibration, and a variety of immunoturbidometric assays which are shown here can all be performed using this instrument. And this is the typical assay procedure for some of the parameters like ASO, CRP. Here, the linearity is up to 22 milligram per DL. Detection limit is 0.5 milligram per DL. And sensitivity, Hook effect is above 84 milligram per DL. And a single calibrator is taken on board, which is diluted by the instrument, accordingly. And the graph is a cubic spline. And here it is only anti-sera and antibody reaction, whereas a high sensitivity CRP uses a latex bound antibody. Then this is the microalbumin assay. And using this instrument, a variety of parameters can be measured. And there is a mixing bar, which is an oscillating mixing probe. So the probe itself acts as a mixing rod, unlike in many of your other analyzers where there is a separate mixing rod and that needs to be washed and so on. Whereas here, when the reagents are pipetted out, it automatically mixes it on board itself and it gets washed, and it prevents the cross-contamination. And there is a 316 stainless steel probe with internal and external washing. And there is an IAD filter which has got a very, very long life. And the reagents are kept cool on board. And there is a photodiode which has got a better sensitivity compared with many other photodiodes. And there are four filters which are used for the measurement of this antigen antibody concentration. So, and the minimum sample volume is only 2 microliters, and the reagent volume is 200 microliters, and it consumes very little water. So with all this, it gives you a very good economy, and interchangeable reagent and sample positions with combination of primary and secondary tubes, like daughter tubes, and they can be barcoded. And stat samples can be placed anywhere in the machine. And there is also something called iTrack with the company, where the instrument is connected online to the company engineers and dedicated specialists. So if there is a problem with the assay, online itself, they will try to solve, and 90% of the problems are sorted out online itself. So engineer need not come to the site. So with all that, the instrument is a perfect instrument for small and medium laboratories. The throughput is about 100 samples per hour. So, we all know what is meant by Hook effect. That is, whenever any sample, in an antigen-antibody reaction, when the antigen concentration is very high, then it becomes, it can give a falsely lowered value. So in this instrument, the Hook effect, they give you exactly at what level is the Hook effect, and many of the parameters, the hook effect is not at all seen. But in most of the other analyses, you will have to have a two-step dilution assay for the avoiding of the high-dose hook effect. So with all this combination, the TurboSpec makes a perfect instrument for measuring many proteins, drugs, and other special compounds in a small or medium-sized laboratory using the immunoturbidometry. Thank you.
Thank you.